So today, and I'm really glad about the publicity that we've had through in all the papers, but right across Scotland we're going to be commemorating the work of all those who campaigned tirelessly in the early decades of last century for the right of women to vote in parliamentary elections. They were the suffragists and the much more well-known and more militant suffragettes.
What's up?
They included men as well as women, so I really appreciate the men that have come along to actually support us, because obviously without their support we wouldn't have got the vote at all. But it was more than just a single act, the extension of the vote to women. It was about a much longer campaign for the extension of equal rights and everything that that meant in terms of men's and society's attitudes and behaviour towards women. So what I wanted to read to you are two contemporary news reports. This is particularly for the Courier reporter. These reports are from 1915, from the old Dundee Advertiser. And I just wanted to test to see if this would spur you on to action. So don't do anything to the windows. First one is a report of the meeting of the Dundee School Board 1915. The board heard of the alleged degeneracy of some Dundee mill girls. A male member, obviously, of the board said that notwithstanding all the efforts of the school board and others, it seemed that generation after generation of young women could leave school and in the course of 2 or 3 years degenerate into such objects that could be seen at the gates of any mill in Dundee masquerading as a suffragette. I did not believe that a mill girl in Dundee took any interest in suffragette matters. That's the first one. And it wasn't actually only men that opposed votes, it was women as well. So here's a report from the 1915 public meeting in Cooper, an anti-votes for women meeting addressed by a female author, a Mrs. Colquhoun, the author of The Vacation of Women. We'll all be writing that down to get a moment. She said, the male point of view is absolutely necessary if the collective life of the state is to be carried out in a far-sighted manner. If the vote is granted to women, a very large number of women would need to be enfranchised. In Cooper, there are 1,800 men and 2,400 women. And if the feminine point of view predominated, then the men would have to fall into line. Yes!
We always do anyway.
If you know it's good for you.
Yeah, we know it's good for us.
But their voices would not have the same quality as men's. I am proud of my sex, she said, but I do not want to see the politics of my country feminised. This drew a large round of applause, and the meeting passed a motion which read thus: the extension of the vote to women would be detrimental to their best interests, their benefit, and disastrous to the welfare of the state. So today we are honouring the work of all those who campaigned with passion against such attitudes that restricted the situation of women. They helped to remove a great injustice that the government of the country should be determined by the votes of only one gender. From that extension of the vote came advances in health provision, childcare, pensions, education, employment rights and so forth. What I might call the feminisation of the state. So that reflected the members, the needs of all members of society, regardless of gender. But today in the news, I was listening to worries expressed about women's pensions, and there's definitely not the representation in any of the parliaments or the council. Helen Wright was here before. Councillor Helen Wright, Bailey, Helen Wright.
Bailey.
But there's still not enough women in the council either. So we have not in any manner and means solved everything, but we have come a long way, and so that's what today is about, to commemorate how far we've come. So thank you very much for coming.